ships at these ports. We owe a great deal to you, Commissioner, and the men and women who serve at these port of entries day in and day out, and I hope you will convey to them our appreciation for their service. Last year, CBP continued to experience remarkable growth in terms of travel and trade. More than 390 million travelers were screened at land, air, and seaports, and nearly $2 trillion worth of imports were processed. The volume of commerce crossing our borders has tripled in the last 25 years. While this continued growth is an overall positive for our economy, we simply will not be able to maintain it without adequately addressing staffing and infrastructure needs. While it's incumbent on the federal government to ensure that CBP has the resources needed to carry out its core functions, Congress must also conduct effective oversight to make sure they're meeting mandates, implementing GAO and OIG recommendations, and operating efficiently. It's concerning to me that as of 2017, despite congressional mandates to hire additional personnel, CBP still has staffing shortages of 2,500 officers, and I know the commissioner will be prepared to give the explanation for that. The General Accounting Office continues to reiterate that this shortage in trade enforcement positions has led to increased wait times, which in some cases could result in shorted vetting processes and security risks, not to mention just the congestion, the air quality issues, and the like. In addition to staffing shortages, CBP officers are required to work in an outdated infrastructure, creating conditions that may affect their ability to expedite inspections and process travelers through high-volume ports. In 2015, CBP self-reported a study that revealed a need for $5 billion to meet its infrastructure and technology requirements. At the border, antiquated infrastructure often leads to unnecessary delays, as I said, which results also in an overall loss of commerce. In many instances, these delays are translated into costs for an entity that ultimately is passed on to the American consumer. So it's critical we make a port of entry infrastructure investment a top priority so that we can adequately staff and fund the ports that make trade possible in the first place. I'm proud to have sponsored legislation, now a part of the law, which directly addresses this issue, the Cross-Border Trade Enhancement Act, which codified the Reimbursable Services Program and Donations Acceptance Program. Public-private partnerships are an effective way to give stakeholders and CBP the ability to make improvements to all types of ports while also saving taxpayer dollars. A number of Texas ports of entry, particularly in the land and the airspace, have already seen the benefits of this program. I also look forward to discussing today other initiatives, Commissioner, currently undertaken by CBP to ease the burden on trade and travel. Programs like the Customs Trade Partnership Against Terrorism, the Nexus Preclearance Program, the FAST Program, and Global Entry can have big benefits for our national security and for the consumer and for the traveler. Further, programs like these allow CBP officers to focus on higher risk goods and travelers. Finally, I look forward to hearing from the Commissioner on implementation of the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act, which moved through this committee a couple of years ago, TFTEA, which officially authorized the Office of Field Operations and streamlined a number of trade enforcement and facilitation issues, has the potential to further enhance our nation's trade policy. I'd now like to recognize the ranking member of the subcommittee, Senator Casey, for any opening statement he'd care to make.
Thanks very much. I want to thank Senator Cornyn for his work and our work together on what has become a series of subcommittee hearings on important matters for our national security and our economic security. Our customs protect both our national and economic security. A secure border must be a priority, and Democrats and Republicans have worked in a bipartisan way to secure $14 billion in funding for customs and border protection, including $1.6 billion for border security. As we work to secure our borders, it's also imperative that our immigration laws are humane and uphold American values. The administration's policy of separating children from their families is an insult to those values, and both parties must insist that families are reunited. The administration must get this done. There's no reason why we cannot develop a border policy that is both humane and protects our national security. It's also imperative that we ensure the safe and secure flow of commerce and have the appropriate staffing and funding levels to prevent unscrupulous actors and trade cheaters from profiting from the sale of dangerous or illicit goods. It's been 2 years since the enactment of the Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act, so-called TFTEA, where we worked in a bipartisan way to provide Customs with new and expanded authority to combat child and slave labor, to protect intellectual property, and to combat those attempting to evade our trade laws. Our customs officers are on the front lines of this fight, working to prevent pirated goods from harming U.S. businesses or dangerous fake goods from harming or even killing consumers, I should say. Our customs officers are responsible for an enormous area of responsibility, from interdicting opioids like fentanyl to illicit goods, adapting to an ever-evolving threat matrix, to our agricultural specialists who protect us from imported pests and disease, and to ensuring that countries like China that cheat on trade cannot circumvent our trade laws. Our customs officers are increasingly under strain. Staffing shortages mean that officers are asked to work double shifts, 16-hour days. Some are asked to serve 90-day tours away from their home and families at facilities that are short-staffed. It's impossible for this not to take a toll on an officer's family's home lives. Commissioner McAleenan, I know that this is something that's important to you as well, and I appreciate that. Safeguarding our long-term competitiveness also means making a sustained and coordinated investment in our infrastructure. Trade is not simply about exports to the rest of the world. It's about American-made goods flowing to destinations across our nation. Our inland waterways are critical to that competitiveness. Our inland waterways provide an economical, environmentally friendly mode of transportation. From Pittsburgh to Louisville, to the Twin Cities, to St. Louis, our inland waterways are responsible for shipping billions in American goods throughout our nation. Our inland waterway system served as an economic backbone for our country as we grew and expanded, connecting pioneers with the rest of our country, bringing goods from our landlocked states to the coasts. This system remains the linchpin of our intermodal system. One of the first things you see at the Port of Pittsburgh are the rail lines. They are truly integrated in the American supply chain, connecting businesses and their products to markets across the country. Keeping our waterway infrastructure navigable is critical to competitiveness for the entire nation. To serve our growing U.S. markets, we must make the kind of concerted infrastructure investments that our parents have the good sense to provide for us. As we must ensure at the same time that agencies tasked with protecting our nation have the funding they need to execute their jobs to the fullest. Mr. Chairman, thank you.
Thank you, Senator Casey. Commissioner McAleenan, if you have an opening statement, please go ahead, and if you'll hold it about 5 minutes, and then that'll give us plenty of time for some Q&A.
Thank you, Chairman Cornyn, Ranking Member Casey, distinguished members of the Subcommittee on Trade. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you on these important matters today. U.S. Customs and Border Protection protects the people of the United States against dynamic threats while simultaneously facilitating lawful trade, travel, and commerce so vital to our nation's economy. It's a broad and diverse mission. Over $4 trillion in international trade moves across our borders each year, 25 million cargo containers via sea, truck, and rail. The volume of packages that arrive via air due to the rise of e-commerce has grown dramatically over the past 5 years. During that time, CBP has seen nearly 50% increase in express shipments, while international mail shipments have increased fourfold, from approximately 150 million to 500 million international mail shipments. These shipments, like their containerized counterparts, pose potential health and safety risks to the United States and to the American people. In terms of illicit narcotics, CBP continues to seize increasing levels of methamphetamines, heroin, and synthetic opioids at our ports of entry, both on our southwest border and in the small parcel environment. We continue to confront trade violations, from dumping and duty evasion to intellectual property rights to elements of forced labor in our supply chains. CBP is undertaking a multifaceted effort to address these trends that relies on our human capital, advanced technology and analytics, interagency and international partnerships, and innovative application of our authorities. To pursue these efforts, the men and women of CBP are our greatest asset. Over the past several years, CBP has faced challenges meeting our hiring goals, but we are taking those challenges head on, making more than 40 improvements to our hiring process, resulting in significant recruitment and hiring gains, despite record low unemployment around the United States and intense competition for highly qualified, mission-inspired people. We've improved our administration of the polygraph examination, and we are working with the private sector on best practices for digital recruiting, applicant care, and automation to reduce our time to hire. We've demonstrated the tremendous value of our trade professionals, from import specialists to regulations and rulings attorneys, and the value they provide to the U.S. economy. And we've requested further investments, for which we will guarantee a return in these personnel in our annual budget requests. We are not yet where we need to be on our staffing, but we are making progress across all categories of CBP professionals required for our critical mission, and hiring and sustaining a world-class workforce will continue to be my top mission support priority for CBP. Supporting our personnel is an array of technology as part of a multi-layered, risk-based approach to target shipments and goods entering our country. For CBP, technology is a force multiplier that helps us work more efficiently with less risk to our frontline personnel. That starts at our National Targeting Center, where every day we analyze 2 million shipments through advanced systems. Through that intelligence analysis, comprehensive data analytics, anomaly identification, and identified trends of concern, CBP is able to segment out high-risk cargo for additional scrutiny while facilitating the flow of legitimate trade. In the field, at our ports of entry, CBP utilizes non-intrusive inspection technology, or NII, to examine and identify anomalies in shipments or vehicles. These systems enable CBP officers to rapidly examine conveyances, such as shipping containers or trucks, and privately owned vehicles for the presence of contraband. We're investing in new technologies and capabilities, using our Laredo field office, encompassing several of our busiest land crossings, as you noted, Mr. Chairman, as a pilot location to continually improve the technology we use to inspect vehicles entering the country. Forensic analysis is used to inform our targeting and support prosecutions and gather intelligence to continually refine our enforcement actions. We're expanding that capability to support controlled substances as well as radiological and nuclear materials. Lastly, infrastructure plays a key role in our ability to detect threats and facilitate trade at our ports of entry. Of our nation's 328 official ports of entry, 110 are land ports. However, most of these inspection facilities were not built to support post-9/11 security and operational missions, much less the tremendous growth in international trade and travel. CBP continues to request funds to construct and modernize these ports of entry along our northern and southern borders and find innovative approaches to meet the growing need for new and expanded facilities. A key aspect of CBP's resource optimization strategy, in addition to the workload staffing model, is the exploration of public-private partnerships through activities such as the Reimbursable Services Program and potential acceptance of donations. Thanks to the support of Congress and the chairman and members of this subcommittee, CBP has expanded authority to enter into these agreements and accept donations of real property, personal property, and non-personal services for activities at ports of entry. That's making an impact and providing a return on investment. Both international commerce and the threat environment are dynamic, and CBP continues to adapt our posture to protect American security and prosperity. I'm proud of the CBP dedicated workforce, appreciate your acknowledgement of them. They continue to meet these challenges with integrity and commitment. Thanks again for the opportunity to appear before you today. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. We'll have 5-minute rounds. And let me just start with something that I know will come up. Senator Casey raised the issue of families coming across the border. Secretary Nielsen said that if a family comes across a port of entry seeking asylum, they're not violating any U.S. criminal laws, are they?
That's correct, Mr. Chairman. They're not violating any laws, presenting without documents, and claiming fear of return to their home country.
So the zero tolerance program of 100% enforcement of illegal crossings would not apply in the case of people coming across the ports of entry, correct?
That's correct. There's no violation of law and no prosecution of those adults that are arriving at ports of entry.
And so the only time where the zero tolerance policy would apply, where somebody is committing an offense under the laws of the United States, would be if they attempt to enter the country between the ports of entry, which is illegal, correct?
That's correct.
Well, I would say, just in conclusion, that I agree with Senator Casey, and I think all of us agree that every effort needs to be made to reunify these families. And Congress needs to come up with a solution here, which only it can provide to that issue. You talked a little bit about technology at the border. I remember that years ago we've been trying to enforce the or come up with technology solutions for the U.S. visit program, where we're able to document everybody who enters the country and everybody who exits the country. And I think there's some technological advances, I believe you alluded to, particularly the facial recognition technology used at airports. Could you expand on that a little bit?
Sure. We're extremely excited about the developments in technology and facial recognition in particular. To meet our congressional mandate to take biometric captures of everyone departing the country, we are working with airports around the country, already in 12 airports, working with multiple air carriers, both U.S. and international, to test this technology. We're piloting both an operation where it serves as the boarding pass for the traveler, as well as just a comparison that allows our system to capture that traveler effectively made an exit from the country. We're seeing 98% match rates in those comparisons. It's working to help enable carriers to board aircraft more efficiently. A380 is in Los Angeles International Airport, where we have a common gate for Lufthansa and British Airways and others. They're boarding them in half the time they were boarding before, using our technology providing that boarding pass capability. So we think that's a tremendous answer for the entry-exit mandate, as well as going to be a key area of how we transform the arrivals process, again, to keep up with this growth. We've had 4% growth in international air arrivals every year since 2009. We're seeing that again this year. To keep up with that travel, which is so critical to our commerce, we're going to need to process those travelers more securely and more efficiently, and facial recognition is going to be a tremendous part of that. It's already in place in Miami and other key areas upon arrival, and we're looking forward to expanding that with our aviation stakeholder partners.
You alluded to this briefly, and that's the public-private partnerships at the border that help address some of the infrastructure deficits that we have. And I know this has been an area where the CBP has experimented, first with pilot projects and now implementing the Border Trade Enhancement Act to take advantage of the generosity of local stakeholders, including our cities and counties. How has that turned out? How has that worked?
That's worked tremendously well. And yes, you're absolutely right, Mr. Chairman. We started with pilots with your support and others in Congress to prove that we could do this, that we could partner with private sector entities, with state and local governments in a way that provided a return on investment, that enhanced the services that we could provide at ports of entry. So at this point, we have 150 reimbursable services agreements at 111 ports across the country. We're able to facilitate additional hours for officers either by overtime or augmenting staff during peak periods. We've had 23 applications for our donation acceptance program, 12 of those in Texas, where it's going to make a big impact in improving the flow at our ports of entry on the land border. So we're very excited about these authorities. We're trying to apply them faithfully and to expand our capacity to serve that commerce.
I recently heard a former head of Southern Command talk about that the transnational criminal organizations that operate outside of the United States being commodity agnostic,
yes,
is what he said, which I took to mean they will traffic in people, they'll traffic in contraband like weapons. They'll traffic in drugs, anything that suits their business model and generates a profit. But could you talk a little bit about the role of the ports of entry when it comes to illegal drugs? Because it looks to me like OFO sees 41,000 pounds of cocaine, 3,700 pounds of heroin, 228 pounds of marijuana, and 52 pounds of methamphetamine, and that was just in fiscal year 2008. But explain to us why it's so important to have the adequate staffing and the adequate infrastructure at the ports of entry when it comes to interdicting these illegal drugs.
Absolutely, and the TCOs are definitely commodity agnostic. The drugs and illicit narcotics are still their number one profit center, but they're also profiting from moving people as well to a dramatic extent, multi-billion dollars a year in Mexico alone. But the ports of entry are critical for interdicting illicit narcotics. That is the pathway of choice into the U.S. across our southwest border or through mail or express consignment. And having adequate personnel to accomplish all of our diverse missions, from the immigration side to inspecting for narcotics, to processing for agriculture protection, and to facilitating that lawful trade and travel is essential. And the technology investments, we received a significant plus up in 18 from Congress for our non-intrusive inspection technology. And that's going to let us put a number of conveyances through secondary examination and identify loads of drugs that we weren't able to see before in both personally owned vehicles and trucks by actually keeping the travelers in the vehicle during the x-ray. The new systems are safe to use with people in vehicles, and it's a very exciting development. We appreciate Congress's support in that area.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. Senator Casey.
Thanks very much. Commissioner, I wanted to start with a topic that's important to me and I think important to people in both parties, and that's how we counter terrorism financing. I've had a major legislation on this that focuses on this problem. I know there are a number of agencies and also a number of committees here in the Senate that focus on it. And I know that when you were going through a confirmation process, you provided responses to us that we appreciated on this topic. I guess two basic questions. Could you discuss, to the extent that you're able in this setting, the work that is ongoing within your agency to coordinate with the rest of the intelligence community to identify and investigate both suspected modes as well as means of terrorism finance, including trade-based money laundering and other means of threat finance?
Absolutely. Given CBP's posture at the border, we have a unique regulatory responsibility and access to data on people and goods crossing that border. So we bring a tremendous amount to the table when we're working with interagency partners on investigative efforts to counter threat finance, specifically for terrorism groups that do use the U.S. economy to help raise money on the gray market, whether it's trafficking in used vehicles or just trade-based money laundering, intellectual property rights violations. We've had several significant cases that we've disrupted along with our partners at Homeland Security Investigations and Senator Menendez's estate and others. And we've created a counter-network division at the National Targeting Center to specifically address these kind of concerns, where we can identify those connections between illicit parties trying to use our commerce to raise money. And partnering with HSI right there at our NTC, they've got a division in the National Targeting Center for Investigations sitting alongside us, building these cases and then taking action. We're trying to use all the authorities across the interagency. We've seen Treasury name a number of parties, denied parties, based on analysis that's been done at our National Targeting Center to prevent them from using our banking system for accessing our commercial supply chain. So we're very proud of this work. We've expanded it significantly with support from Congress over the last 5 years, and we intend to continue to drive forward in that area. It's a critical mission for us.
Thank you for that. And I'd ask you generally, but in particular in this area, if there are resources or authorities that you need to help you over the course of today would present those to us or itemize them. I wanted to go back to it as well in the remaining time I have in this round to ask you about the budget again. And I was highlighting before the staffing levels. According to your workload model, Customs would need to hire an additional 2,500 officers, 721 agriculture specialists to achieve its staffing targets. I know at the airport in Philly, there's alone, just in that one place, are short 8 to 10 customs officers. So there is an understaffing issue. I was, to say I was disappointed is an understatement, that Director Mulvaney didn't ask for additional appropriated funds to address the shortfall. But we can work together here to address it. We have officers who are regularly asked to do double shifts, as I mentioned, assignments away from their families. That can affect the family as well as morale. Can you walk through some of the strains, just by way, if you could, of just itemizing where you need the most help in terms of getting those dollars up for staffing?
Sure. Thank you, Senator, for asking about our staffing approaches for the ports of entry. We're very pleased to receive support from Congress for 328 officers in the fiscal year 18 budget. We intend to make that hiring goal this year. We're making very good progress towards it. We also saw in the Senate Appropriations Committee markup continued support for CBP officers through appropriated dollars, 375 additional officers, which is outstanding. Just to clarify, because this is an effort across the last two administrations to provide a workload staffing model that gives a good sense of the number of staff we need to carry out our mission effectively based on volume, workload, emerging and changing threats, but also the technology and the partnerships we're able to bring to bear on our mission set. Alongside that staffing model, we've submitted to Congress authorizing language requesting the ability to increase our fees, which are in several cases over 15 years since we've had any update of those fees. They've not kept pace with inflation. And the requested increases in those fees we've asked for would meet and exceed actually the total number of staff that we've requested under the workload staffing model. So that's something we'd like to partner on. We do believe that that's an ongoing partnership with the trade and travel industries to make sure that we can provide the services they need.
Great. Thank you very much, Commissioner.
Senator Isaacson.
Thank you, Senator Cornyn. Welcome. Glad to have you. At your confirmation, we discussed the numbers of employees at CBP at the Port of Savannah. Since that time, we passed the Border Jobs for Veterans Act of 2015, or since that time. Have you utilized any of the programs in the 2015 Act to expand employment at Savannah or any other port in the country?
We've made use of every authority that Congress has given us in terms of streamlining and enhancing our hiring. About 30% of our workforce are veterans. We've done outreach to DOD across multiple major bases where we have significant numbers of transitioning members so that we can onboard them more efficiently. We can treat their outgoing medical exam as our inbound medical exam, for instance, and our hiring of veterans has increased. And Savannah is no exception. My head of trade relations is in Savannah today, meeting with Port Authority leadership, as well as our Office of Trade Executive Director, talking about how we can keep up with the growth there in Savannah, with the additional dredging and the depth of the channel that you have there. It's a critical port and partnership for us.
We've got about 800,000 veterans in the state, retirees. We have a number of bases in the state, many of them close to the Port of Savannah. You probably don't have a better potential qualified candidate for employment for your responsibilities than your veteran who's come back from the training and service through the country. So I'm glad you're utilizing that. I hope you'll continue to. And any way we can, as chairman of the Veterans Committee in the Senate, any way we can be of help to you to promote your operation as a place for veterans to come and look, we'll be sure and do that. And if you ever get in touch with our staff and tell them any information you'd like for us to do, we'll disseminate that information very readily. Second, on the Port of Savannah, we're very proud of that port. It's the largest bulk port on the East Coast of the United States and profitable. It's being expanded thanks to the graciousness of members of the Senate and the House and the President of the United States, the last three Presidents of the United States. We're going to get to 47 feet within about 3 to 4 years. It's going to be bringing in the new, what do they call, C-MAX ships coming in, which carry 14,000 containers per for boat. To give you a little comparison, the boats they get now is 9,000, so it's about a 30% increase in throughput. My question is this. We have the Elba Island liquefied natural gas port there. We have the tremendous number of tons of materials coming in there. We have lots of ships from all around the world coming in there. I'm always concerned about the security and how well we're enforcing the security vis-a-vis the potential of a terrorist attack. We have not had one, and hope we never do have one, but one of the reasons you don't ever have one is the preparation you do to prepare yourself to plan for them. Could you tell me for a minute, in terms of that part, how you feel about our security in its current form, and do you see any additional needs that we need to provide for you to be sure it's as secure as possible?
Sure, Senator. So on our security, it's a collaboration with the U.S. Coast Guard. They're the lead for port security, as you know. Commandant Schultz, former Atlantic Area Commander, has a very good handle on the port security issues in Savannah and really all over the Eastern Seaboard and around the country. For CBP, we partner directly with the Coast Guard, both at the national level and in the field. Coast Guard has their targeting unit sitting with us at our National Targeting Center. So we're looking at the same data collected under Coast Guard authority, but then processed and analyzed with CBP systems to provide targets for them to look at, both in terms of any risks presented by the passengers and crew on a vessel, but also the cargo on that vessel. So we have an integrated risk assessment process of the people and goods on that vessel that are then conveyed out to our field elements for appropriate action. The captain of the port then decides which vessels they need to escort in and provide safety. CBP helps from an immigration perspective determine which people and crew we might need to hold on board during their stay in the U.S. and make sure they're secured during the time they're in port. And that's a collaborative process that I think works very well. I will definitely circle back with my Coast Guard counterparts to see if there are unmet needs in that port security effort in Savannah or elsewhere. But we feel pretty good about our collaboration and our common operating picture that we have at this point.
I don't know it any. That didn't prompt the question. What prompted the question, though, however, was to get a little information out to the public. I have people ask me sometimes, how in the world do you protect a port? And I start off by telling about the known shipper program and telling mm-hmm. about the Coast Guard. And the Coast Guard at Savannah flies out to the outer marker where the ships that come in that have not filed a known shipper report at the point of embarkation when they left to come, that ship is searched 3 miles out
right.
with the help of the Coast Guard. The ships that are fully locked up, fully searched, and fully inventoried when they come in and can offload them pretty quickly. So it's motivated. The shippers are motivated to bring in a full cargo that's completely itemized, completely reported, and easy to inspect. And so you have a great secure system, and the Coast Guard does a magnificent job.
Tremendous.
Seeing to it that we get those inspections done. So I wanted that information to get out to every Georgian and really every American because of the value of those ports. Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Senator Portman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Commissioner McAleenan, thank you for your service. And those of your officers, we appreciate what they do every day, including, of course, interdicting heroin, fentanyl, other drugs coming into our country. We're trying to help you on that, by the way. The STOP Act, as you and I have talked about many times, would be a tremendous help to give you the data that you need to interdict these packages that are coming in from overseas primarily, mostly from China. And as you know, fentanyl is now the number one killer in my home state, and I believe among the opioids, number one killer in the country. And so we hope to follow suit with the House very shortly and get you those tools. I've talked to you briefly before the hearing started to warn you about what I was going to talk about, but it's a big issue. But you have a specific role that would really help. And it has to do with these steel tariffs, their impact on our economy, and how we go about ensuring a level playing field. The 232 measures, which are under a national security, really a waiver under our trade law, doesn't require us to show an injury to our industry. It doesn't require us to show any unfair trade. But as you can see, other countries are retaliating aggressively against us as we use this tool. My fear is those trade escalations will continue. It's going to hurt our consumers, but also our exporters and our manufacturers. So what's the problem? Well, the major problem, everybody seems to agree, is overcapacity, steel production in this world. And primarily that's, again, China. About 15 years ago, they had 15% of the global production. Now they have about half the global production. And they do sell their steel at below cost. We've been able to show that and win some trade cases on that. And I think that's good. One of the problems is they transship it through other countries. And that's why, working with Senator Wyden and others, we passed this legislation called the Enforce and Protect Act, also known as the Enforce Act, because we recognized the overcapacity problem, wanted to deal with the duty evasion issue and the transshipment issue. And we vested a lot of responsibility in you and your people. I know you got a lot to do with people and drugs and other issues related to commerce, but this one is really important. And frankly, I don't know that we would need to have a 232 case and have all of the potentially negative consequences that come from that if we were doing a better job on transshipment. I know you appreciate its importance. We've had some successes in the wire coat hanger case. For example, the Enforce Act was essential in saving the last manufacturer in the United States. Couldn't have done it without the legislation, without your help. Unfortunately, with all the things that have distracted your people and your lack of hiring and so on, we talked about earlier, the legislation remains underutilized. One reason, I think, is that we don't see as many allegations as we should because we don't have this ability to have administrative protective orders. The International Trade Commission, Department of Commerce, both successfully use these, the APOs, administrative protective orders, to facilitate confidential information sharing with interested parties. And I strongly believe that there's an opportunity to apply that here to the Enforce Act. I've heard from a lot of stakeholders about this. They want this process at CBP because they understand how useful it can be. I know you don't have the legal authority to do it yourself, but I want to hear from you today. Do you believe that creation of an APO process under the Enforce Act would make the process more useful for petitioners and thus increase the number of petitions?
Thank you, Senator, for the question and to the committee for the authority under the Enforce Act, which we've taken on, implementing an interim final rule within 6 months of the passage of the Trade Facilitation Trade Enforcement Act. We're now up to 20 investigations, 9 completed, $50 million in duty evasion prevention accomplished. We've done foreign site visits in over 18 locations, which has really given us a sense of where there's a fraudulent issue, a fake transshipment, if you will. We're able to actually look at that factory using our international network, our partnership with foreign governments and with HSI.
By the way, your interim rules came out in August of 2016. We're still waiting to the final regulations. So if you could also tell us today when you expect those final regulations to come out, that would be helpful.
Well,
do you have an answer on that?
Actually, I think that depends on the second half of your question, mm-hmm. the ongoing lessons learned from these 20 investigations and the incoming allegations under the Enforce Act, the lessons we take from those, and how we want to apply them in a final rule. The administrative protective order process is something that we've looked at and that we're happy to have an ongoing conversation with Congress about. As you noted, we don't have the authority or the resources to implement it today.
Do you think it would be helpful?
I think that the key elements of it, the sharing of additional information with interested party, is very helpful.
Okay.
And whether we can do that through a final rule on our own or whether an APO would materially advance that's worth discussing, absolutely.
But you want to get that confidential information. Another area we can improve the Enforce Act would be to allow petitioners to file allegations when the importer is not known, because that's the case sometimes. They see an evasion coming, they're tracking prices, market dynamics. They know it's happening, they're just not sure who's doing it. Again, legal authority aside, do you believe that permitting allegations when an importer is unknown would make the process more useful for petitioners and help increase the number of petitions?
Yes, we agree with that. That's an improvement we'd like to make in the process.
So it sounds like the first one you'd like to make the change substantively, whether it's through an APO or some other way, and the second one you believe people ought to be able to file these cases without knowing the importer.
Correct.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Menendez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner, let me first salute the men and women in the service who work at Port Elizabeth in Newark and Newark International Airport. They do a fantastic job. And the megaport of the East Coast, we appreciate their work. But I want to turn to a line of questioning that started off where the chairman started off his line of questioning. On June the 18th, Secretary Nielsen said that if an adult enters at a port of entry and claims asylum, they will not face prosecution for illegal entry. They have not committed a crime by coming to the port of entry. And the same day, the Department of Homeland Security called it a myth that families who cross the border seek asylum at ports of entry are separated. But advocates and press stories tell us a different story. How many children were, in fact, separated from their parents at ports of entry during the family separation policy?
Under the zero tolerance and prosecutions, family separation efforts, zero. We had 7 separations during that time period that were due to an unproven family relationship or an unrelated criminal history or violation. There were several thousand, 5,200 families that arrived during that time frame. None of them were separated. None of them were separated due to prosecution just for claiming asylum.
So none at a port of entry. You're telling me none at a port of entry were separated?
Not purely for the Zero Tolerance Initiative. There had to be an underlying criminal history element or something else in the presentation, fraud or not a family relationship.
That would be the only reason they would have been separated.
Correct.
All right, let me ask you this. One of the things that we keep hearing about is that DHS has repeatedly encouraged migrants seeking asylum, well, first to do it in their home country, but if not, to do it, to cross at ports of entry and not in between ports of entry. Now, we've seen pictures of custom officers standing on bridges on the border in El Paso, keeping migrants on the Mexican side of the border. And that has prompted some those seeking asylum to set up camps on the bridges while they're waiting to make an asylum claim. Now, CBP claims that no one at a port of entry is being denied an opportunity to make a claim of asylum, but that there are capacity issues. Effectively, asylum seekers are being turned away at ports of entry and told to come back later. How long are the wait times at the port of entry on the southern border to receive families who are claiming asylum?
Sure. This is something we monitor very carefully. We have a daily report that I receive, that our Executive Assistant Commissioner for Field Operations receives. And on any given day, at our 26 international crossings at that southwest border, there might be 3 to 4 ports that have any wait time for people that want to present without documents. Generally, 1 or 2 of the ports in Texas will have 10 to 50 people waiting. They'll be waiting a matter of hours, generally processed in the same day. The one outlier we have is the port of entry in San Ysidro, which is between San Diego and Tijuana, as you know, where the majority of people arriving seeking asylum come in. There's a shelter network there. There's an effort coordinated by our Mexican counterparts to provide people awareness on when they can come to the port of entry, when we have space. But that balance to try to make sure that people are housed in space where we have capacity, where it's a safe and appropriate environment, as well as balancing across all the other missions that we've talked about, is what we're trying to manage.
How many potential asylum seekers are waiting on the other side, who have waited and presented themselves formally to a port of entry but cannot be processed because of capacity issues?
Border wide or in San Ysidro?
Let's start with San Ysidro. You said that's the biggest.
San Ysidro is the 95%+ of the folks waiting are in San Ysidro. It's over 1,000 right now.
Over 1,000?
Correct.
How long have they been waiting there?
On average, 7 to 14 days is the current information I have.
Uh-huh. And what have you instructed CBP officials to tell individuals seeking asylum when they come to a port of entry? And what are you doing to accelerate the ability to actually take their asylum applications?
So, as you know, our ability to take people in depends on our counterparts in the immigration system to pick them up after we finish processing them at the port of entry. So it depends on ICE capacity to pick people up who are in our custody. It depends on our staffing capacity. Just to give the committee and the people watching a sense of how much effort goes into this, at San Ysidro, where we have 130,000 people arriving a day, 20+% of our arrivals on the southwest border. We take about 10 to 15% of our staff.
Those are not asylum seekers.
No, those are lawful travelers for commerce. Right. We take about 10 to 15% of our staff to focus on those arriving without documents. And we're taking in anywhere from 50 to 100 a day. So it's a huge effort to carefully process them, to do interviews and sworn statements. And we're trying to balance that against that lawful travel and the fact that San Ysidro is one of our top locations for illicit narcotics trying to enter the country. So it's a balance every day. We're trying to take as many people as we can in who present without documents. As you point out, that is the lawful, appropriate way to seek asylum in the U.S.
I'll submit the question for the record, but I'd like to know, what is the totality of the other ports, this being the largest one, obviously, but I'd like to know the totality.
Today there was one port with 50 and another with 25 waiting. Correct.
That's it. Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Carper.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Krishna. It's good to see you. Thank you very much for your service. A couple of weeks ago, I believe the Vice President was going to head down to Latin America. And he apparently had planned to make a stop in, I think, in Guatemala. And it ended up being a longer stop than was initially anticipated. And my understanding is that He may have met with the president of Guatemala, maybe the president of Honduras, and maybe the vice president of El Salvador. I've not heard much at all about that meetings, but as you know, you and I and others on this committee, including our chairs, co-chairs, are interested in root causes and not just addressing symptoms of problems, but root causes. And haven't talked to the vice president lately to see if that meeting, what kind of takeaways he got from the meeting. What transpired? Did they discuss Alliance for Prosperity? Do you have can you shed any light on that?
Certainly. I appreciate the question, Senator Carper. Good to see you. I had a chance to talk to the vice president about some of these issues before his trip and how important this engagement in Central America is. And Secretary Nielsen's been championing this effort as well. She actually flew down and spent that day with the vice president in Guatemala and then subsequently led a delegation down last Friday. I joined her along with a number of State Department officials, Ron Vitello, the acting director at ICE, to meet with our Northern Triangle counterparts, foreign ministers and interior ministers, but also Mexico, because it's got to be a shared effort. Canada sent a delegation as well to participate in those discussions.
Yeah, give us a report on those discussions. That's good.
They were robust. Obviously, there was discussion about U.S. immigration policy and enforcement efforts, but also talk about how we can collaborate together on getting clear messaging to potential migrants leaving the Northern Triangle. Their desire is to keep their youth and energy home, to invest in them, to create economic opportunity. So they wanted us to share that effort to message. We also talked, of course, about tackling the smuggling organizations. But very importantly, we had an extensive dialogue about the economic prosperity opportunities. The government of El Salvador talked about the customs union that they're creating among the three Northern Triangle countries. I'll be going down in September to talk about how CBP, ideally with Mexico.
When in September?
Mid-September right now is the dates we're planning. Mm-hmm. We want to bring a package of support, both on the security side where we're already having vetted units, we're already helping them with their automated targeting systems, but we want to add that customs element. If they could collect duties and VAT taxes with integrity and transparency, that would add to the government collections, enable them to invest in their economic efforts. So it's really got to be multifaceted. We then met with the ambassadors 4 days later on Thursday.
Do we have ambassadors in all three countries?
We do. Okay. CBP has staff in all three countries on site as attachés as well as advisors.
But we have confirmed ambassadors in all three countries.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. I don't know. I think we might have a chargé in one of the three.
Okay.
But we met with the ambassadors from the Northern Triangle then that Thursday. My team met with them again Monday on the messaging, and we have a vice ministerial meeting in Tegucigalpa on the 26th. So the root cause effort, which has been a bipartisan support from Congress to invest in the Alliance for Prosperity, is robust. It's a strong commitment from state alongside Homeland Security, and CBP is committed to being part of that solution.
Good. Thanks. Let's stay in touch on this. As you know, long-time interest very much. I want to stay on top of it. That's good. I need to get back down there soon.
And okay.
Maybe September, we'll see.
All right. That'd be great.
I'll be your wingman.
Okay.
just to switch gears a little bit, aside from root causes, addressing the root causes, maybe give us one or two other appropriate measures that are on your mind, from the front of your mind, toward reducing migration from the Northern Triangle these days.
Right. So I think we have to have regional efforts to align migration policies and to make sure that there are safety valves for those that need protections without putting themselves in the hands of smugglers. The situation we have now with the most vulnerable people in our hemisphere, putting themselves in the hands of the most violent criminal organizations in the world is not acceptable. They are profiting on the backs of these vulnerable people. They are fighting over the territory, the access to the river, in a way that's absolutely devastating to the people of Tamaulipas, where they have a 100% increase in the murder rate in the last 18 months based on an organization just fighting for that last inch to the river, where they're able to charge an extra $500 to everybody trying to cross into the U.S. illegally. 122 politicians killed in Mexico in the last election cycle, 122 candidates. And that's fueled by our drug demand and fueled by our immigration policy. So we need to find a way with the transition process, with the new government of the president-elect, to continue our collaboration on targeting these networks, to partner on migration flows in a way that reduces the demand and keeps it out of the hands of these criminals.
Thanks. I would just say to our chair and ranking member that maybe the idea of a Senate delegation of just senators whose last names start with C to go down to visit the Northern Triangle this fall.
This Senator Carper's comments about a request question about ambassadors and about State Department and other staffing down in Central America, I think, is entirely appropriate. Secretary Pompeo, who I happened to talk to last night, confirmed that there's a lot of vacancies in U.S. representatives, ambassadors, diplomatic representation. And if we're going to try to figure out a solution to this problem on a regional basis, like the commissioner said, we're going to have our best people confirmed and in place. And perhaps that's something we can work on together along with our friend from Pennsylvania, because that shouldn't be about politics. That ought to be about trying to advance American interests and come up with solutions. So I appreciate you raising that issue. Commissioner, thank you very much for being here. There's so much more we could talk about, but you've been very patient along with the rest of our second panel. So we will excuse you for now, and we will look forward to staying in touch and trying to support your mission the best we can. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member. Great panel behind me here, so I'll get out of the way.